up with.
Sounds good.
Yeah, Professor, how is everything going? So, in this pandemic and all.
Yeah, it's very busy, unfortunately. It's yeah, I think one thing for me that changed for me was that I became a lot more accessible to people. And it's good because you meet a lot of new people, but on the other hand, the time gets really scarce. But it's good to be here today, so yeah. How about you? Did your studies change with kind of this online type of study plan? Is that different now for you, or do you feel that it's
Yeah.
different? Is it more difficult to engage?
Yeah, mostly our institute had mostly giving that online semester next time, so yeah.
Yeah, I think the majority of universities are going to be teaching in online mode until the end of the year. Yeah, some universities now allow like small group teaching in classes, but yeah, it's very, yeah, it's a it, I think it will be online. I think Google announced today that they're going to keep their staff in working from home mode until next summer. So they're kind of thinking a year from now. But yeah, so I'm not sure whether that's going to be the standard. But yeah, definitely a lot of challenging things. Like I don't know. Like to me, the problem with online teaching is I don't actually see the reactions of people. It's very difficult to understand whether, like how you're doing during the talk. It's just you see your slides, this is slightly weird. Yeah.
So I would request all the participants to on their videos will be good.
Yeah, but I mean, you don't have to. It's just, yeah, I mean, I guess it's the questions at the end are fine. If you just ask questions, that's good. Yeah, but yeah, just, like normally when you have an audience, you can see people. But I think with the current kind of online talks, you can access more talks and also give more talks, I guess. Yeah, so that's good.
Yeah. Let's wait for the few more to join. So I would like to introduce Harshit. He is my teammate and we guys yeah really did a lot of hard work in advertising this event to make it successful and
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you, Harshit. Yeah,
always
nice
a
to meet
pleasure,
you.
always a pleasure. You
Nice to
too.
meet you. Nice to meet
Yeah,
you.
I think we can wait for another 3 minutes because we had over about I think about 90 or 100 participants, right, who'd registered, Akshay.
Yeah.
So I think there will be more people turning up, so let's give them a couple of minutes probably.
Yeah,
Is
no
that
worries.
okay? Awesome.
Yeah, no worries, no worries. Yeah, I think usually you expect about 70% to turn up. So that's not
Definitely correct.
yeah, it's not everybody who said they will actually attend.
Correct.
Yeah. But you are recording, right? So you I guess you could then also make it available somewhere, or
Yeah.
is that the plan? Okay. Yeah, I guess data science is one of those subjects that's not very tough to learn remotely. But yeah, if you are in, I don't know, engineering or medicine, that's pretty tough to do that. Yeah.
It's a really interesting subject, that data science.
Yeah. And currently, I think there are a lot of different options to study data science. It's, you know, you can study data analytics, you can study data science, you can study some like business analytics, which is kind of also very close to analytics. Yeah. Data engineering.
Yeah, that's true.
So what is the situation in India with COVID? Is it, I don't know, I mean, I'm not actually aware of the current. I mean, I looked at it, at the data at the beginning of pandemic, and now I don't know actually how is it, do you see improvement or is it, do you see the second wave like some countries do? Like what's going on?
Still, we are not on the verge of receiving the second wave, but India is seeing the peak. In the cases as daily, we are having approx 40 to 45,000 cases coming. But the situation is under control as health departments and the hospitals are really prepared for this situation. So yeah, I think India has prepared to fight this pandemic.
Oh, that's good, yeah. Yeah, I was only looking at hand washing at the beginning of pandemic, and I worked with a journalist from National Geographic in India on a piece where we basically, we wrote on kind of the importance of hand washing and like how hand washing habit was correlated with the initial spread. But yeah. But I mean, she contacted us and said, well, she contacted me and my co-author and said, well, you know, like in India, you can actually often get access to clean water. Like, it's not realistic what, you know, the World Health Organization is advising. So that was quite important part, quite important piece of what we were doing. Anyway, so we had this piece written with her. I mean, she wrote about our research and like we commented that, yeah, I mean, it's not a feasible policy for all countries to just recommend people that they wash their hands. And
So we can start now.
Yeah, so that's good. Yeah, I'm happy to do that.
So hello everyone. So welcome to today's webinar, Behavioral Data Science. I hope all of you are well aware and are really excited about today's session. So my name is Akshay Nayak, and along with my other mates, Harshit Balagur and Agra Jiyasu, I will be your moderator today. And I'm really excited to be hosting this webinar today. And I'm pleased to introduce today's speaker, Professor Gana. How are you, Professor?
Hi. Yeah, thanks. Thanks a lot, Akshay. And I'm just going to say that, so if you guys have any questions during the session, please pop them in the chat. And I'm going to let Akshay and Harshit to kind of navigate through the questions afterwards and kind of give you the floor for questions. Let me just try to share.
And I'm really thankful that you have taken some of your precious time, Professor.
Oh, no worries. Yeah, it's my pleasure. Let me just share my screen, see if I can go to my presentation. Can you see my presentation now?
No, Professor.
No. How about now? Can you see my slides now? No?
Not yet.
Okay, maybe let me just try and show and try something else. Maybe I should share something else. If I click present, I'm just gonna try to share a window instead of a. Did that go to a presentation?
Yeah, it's a presentation.
Okay, good. Yay. Can you see my slides now?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So hi, yeah, I'm Ganna Pogrebna. I'm a behavioral data scientist. And basically today we're going to talk about behavioral data science, what it is. And I will focus on methodology and applications. And I work on a lot of different projects and a lot of different areas. Mostly the areas that I work on concern media, racing, cybersecurity, and smart cities. That's kind of four things that I'm particularly passionate about. So today I'm going to show you just basically some examples of these projects that I'm working on and just generally talk about behavioral data science. Before I go into this, I just want to say that I'm a fellow at the Alan Turing Institute, where I lead behavioral data science trend. So if you haven't heard about the Alan Turing Institute, you can go at turing.ac.uk. That's turing.ac.uk. That's the website. And basically, yeah, you will see information about the institute. The institute essentially is a national center of excellence for data science in United Kingdom. And originally, it was set up by five universities. That was Oxford, Cambridge, UCL, University of Warwick, and University of Edinburgh. And now it includes 13 different universities in the UK. And basically, people who are kind of top data scientists in the country are kind of working in this institute. Apart from having the jobs in the relative universities, they also meet in London. I just want to say that many people do not realize that the Alan Turing Institute events are available to public. So if you just go to turing.ac.uk and click on events, normally the overwhelming majority of events are open to public. So you are welcome to attend any event or masterclass or talk there. So please, by all means, check out the website and do tune in for various events. So I lead behavioral data science trend, and we do have a number of events. We also have a podcast series and all sorts of interesting things. But there are 9 programs within the Alan Turing Institute, so I'm sure you will find something that you will find useful for yourself. Okay, so let's just kick on with behavioral data science. So yeah, so originally I was trained as a decision theorist. So decision theorists are people who kind of work between economics and psychology on a very mathematical side of it. And they write models about human behavior, and then they test these models using various laboratory experiments and field experiments. So that's what I was doing originally. But then, in 2013, I got a job in engineering department and I started to do data science, basically, because I was working with a lot of engineers. And I just wanted to show you that a lot of people are currently talking about the decline of data sciences, behavioral science compared to data science. And this is kind of Google Trends for the last 5 years or so. And you can see that behavioral data science line, you cannot even see it. In terms of experimental economics, which is a related field, it kind of is there, like almost at zero. And then we have AI, which is very popular, and machine learning, for example, that is kind of purple. But you can imagine that the line for, if you extend this red line, when it could potentially meet the green line or even the purple or the yellow line. So when I was originally thinking about my research, I was thinking, you know, that I write all these mathematical models of human behavior, but these models never actually make it to industry or, you know, any applied research. So I just decided that I want to do something that, you know, is more relevant to the society. And yeah, so what kind of emerged over a course of several years was behavioral data science. And so essentially, behavioral data science is a new field. So behavioral data science is not just business analytics. And I just want to ask you as students to kind of, when you read about behavioral data science, please read resources that are coming from scientists who do research or practitioners who actually work in behavioral data science, because there is a lot of information online, and it's behavioral data science is very easily confused with behavioral analytics, for example. So behavioral analytics is particularly looking at human behavior and consumer behavior, whereas behavioral data science talks about algorithms, people, and systems. So it's not just about people. So in terms of theory, it's not behavioral analytics. And in terms of practice, it's not a fancy marketing, because I heard that from my friend that, oh, you know, behavioral data science is just a fancy marketing in terms of practice. No, it's not. So when we think about behavioral data science, actually it concerns these three areas. It's human behavior, algorithmic behavior, and systems behavior. Of course, there is a lot of research here on human behavior, but also, you know, in algorithmic and systems behavior. One of the common theme, for example, for all of these three things is, for example, biases. You know that human behavior is biased in many ways, but algorithmic behavior is also biased in many ways. And then we want to understand how all of this kind of affects systems that we build, right? So we do build systems sometimes that are not fair for many different groups of people. So in that sense, behavioral data science is very useful to understand these types of questions. But so this is just one example. If you go on the website of our group, a behavioral data science group within the Alan Turing Institute, you will see that there are many topics that people are interested in, for example, well-being, like I said, cybersecurity or environmental issues. So all sorts of issues. And normally they include these three strands: human behavior, algorithmic behavior, and systems behavior. Okay, so how exactly behavioral science is different from the rest? So we have behavioral science and we have data science, right? And behavioral data science is a mix of these two. So when you think about behavioral science, it's a conceptual science. So it's like, I mean, if you're in a technical subject, then you can think about it as mathematics, right? When you think about data science, this is methodological. So it's really kind of practical thing where you are trying to understand how you can improve systems, how you can improve algorithms, how you can improve behavior. So this is more methodological. So you can think about kind of conceptual methodological. This is like conceptual is more like mathematics, and methodological is like engineering. So what we're trying to do is kind of mix the two in behavioral data science. So we're trying to have a very fundamental kind of foundations in the science, but also really applicable and relevant methods to address various behavioral problems. And like I said, we are concerned with human, algorithmic, and systems behavior. So behavioral data science can enrich conceptual frameworks for data science methods. So hypothesis testing at scale. So we can have hypotheses from behavioral science and we can test them at scale using data science. We can also detect deficiencies in data science methodologies using conceptual models. So for example, we know that algorithms, like I said, algorithms are biased in various ways. So behavioral theory could help us understand what are those biases when we look at algorithms, Okay. And not only, you know, understanding that they emerged from emerged as a result of using historical data, but we also can identify why, at which points do we have problems with data, for example. And then we also can modify algorithms to bring in behavioral science models into AI. And I will try to showcase all these three things today. So the last one is something that I particularly concentrate on. For example, I work on a model that is called anthropomorphic learning model. And that kind of is exactly that. It's kind of a mix of data science methods. It's a hybrid model between data science and artificial intelligence. Machine learning. Okay, so today we're going to look at scaled up customization, responsible personalization, and data-driven improvement of customer satisfaction. So these are three kind of specific examples that I want to give. And yeah, feel free to ask questions. Please use the chat for now so that you don't forget the question, and then you can ask your question at the end. Okay, so scaled up customization. So scaled up customization is something that I'm really interested in. So as you know, we all have preferences, and companies want to fit our preferences in the best way possible. And so this is kind of one of my most recent, but at the same time most famous projects, where we basically used behavioral data science to improve the productivity of Hollywood movie production. So essentially, the point of this project is the following. So usually when you are making a movie, you have a very limited number of people who work on this project. So you have a director, you have a scriptwriter, you have a producer. And usually this small group of people makes a decision about what the movie is going to be, right? And producers normally have a lot of weight in this decision. So this project kind of looks at this problem backwards. So can we understand what the viewer really wants to see, and then engineer the content in such a way that people actually will be more likely to see it to pay for it? And that's exactly what we do in this project. So we just use natural language processing technique. I'm going to explain to you exactly what we do. But what we do, we basically map sentiment. And from the sentiment, we obtain clusters of movies. And then we basically use these clusters in an econometric model to predict revenue. So we're trying to understand what movies with what type of emotional arc, as we call it, will be the most profitable. Okay, and we just use text. We do not use image. So here we just use scripts, just pure text that we can see. So this theory actually dates back to Aristotle. Even Aristotle suggested that you could actually use emotional arcs to better design content for tragedies, for example. But this guy, Kurt Vonnegut, was an American producer and scriptwriter who came up with the theory that you can actually map emotion throughout the script. So what basically you have here is normalized emotional arc. So here you have the time of the movie from beginning to end. And these are happy messages, these are sad messages, and you can kind of just map what it is. So, and that's exactly how we are going to think about this these emotional arcs. We also have normalized way of doing that. So what are the hypotheses for this project? So before we started our project, we actually found a project that was done by Regan and co-authors in 2016, who used over 1,000 of books or novels that they mined from online library. And they kind of mapped these clusters of stories, and they showed that all the stories that they could find in this particular library could be Basically organized in this six clusters: Rex to Riches, Riches to Rex, Man in the Hole, Icarus, Cinderella, and Oedipus. And basically, I'm going to go through each in a second when I show you movies. But essentially, yeah. So the point of this is that, you know, all stories could be kind of organized into these six groups. But unfortunately, they didn't do anything else. So they didn't look at book popularity based on the rank, this emotional arc. And again, like I said before, so this is the beginning of the story, this is the end of the story, and this is emotion from kind of happy messages to sad messages. So I hope that's clear. So yeah, I mean, this is basically the setting. What we wanted to do in our study is we wanted to look at whether we could find the same six emotional arcs in movies, because our assumption was that successful films are probably based on successful stories. So this should be quite similar. But on the other hand, you know, it's not really, for example, I wasn't really convinced that we will find exactly six. So I wanted to see how many, you know, potentially how many clusters we will actually find. So these are our clusters. I haven't done a very good job at drawing some of them. So you can basically, it seems like that might not be a pattern, but it is actually a pattern. So just trust me on this one. It's just a visual that I produced wasn't very nice. But essentially the point here is that we found exactly the same six clusters in the movies that we analyzed, and we analyzed a lot of movies, so I will go through the sample in a second. And we found that, yeah, so we have the six clusters. So Rex to Riches, this is basically a film that starts with unhappy messages and then goes to happy message. So normally biopics are like this, right? Someone starts in slums and then goes to be, I don't know, Bill Gates or something like this. Then you have tragedy. So tragedy, this is the normal arc. So you start with relatively happy messages and you go to really sad messages. Then you have a U-shaped one. This is Man in a Hole. Icarus, so when you have sad message, then happy, then sad, and kind of slight improvement at the end. Cinderella, I always forget how it goes, but if you think about Cinderella story, you will recall that, you know, first Cinderella goes to a ball, then she gets in trouble, loses a shoe, and then she marries the prince. It kind of goes like this. And then Oedipus is a mirror image of Cinderella story. So, like I said, the paper is available in free access online, so you can basically find it and read it. What was striking about this finding is not just that we found these emotional arcs, but also we found that this particular arc, Man in the Hole, gave you a lot more money than any other arc. So this was the most financially successful in terms of box offices. So how exactly did we go about this, doing this project? So we actually mined the entire database of IMDb. So we have over 4 million titles of movies. And then we found scripts, subtitles. Well, so we couldn't really find the original scripts for all the movies, but we did mine subtitles from opensubtitles.org. And we have over 156,000 subtitles. And this is kind of a story when you start with a really large data set and then it becomes smaller and smaller as you go along. And then from numbers.com, we found the budgets. So we only had budgets for about 9,000 movies. And then after we did the cleansing and kind of cutting of the doubles and all these types of things, so we ended up with this 6,174 records, and that basically we just essentially mapped. So for each film, we just mapped an emotional arc using R package. I mean, you can do it in Python if you prefer, but I mean, for this particular project, we used R. But in, like I said, I mean, it's not, you don't have to use R, you can use any other package. And then, so for each movie, we came up with an emotional arc, and then we basically clustered to this emotional arcs and films into the six clusters. So you can use k-means clustering to cluster them, but you know, we used some kind of k-means with a twist. But it doesn't really matter. Like you could use any clustering procedure in principle, and it will provide you with some sort of groupings. So we tried many different ways, but this was kind of the most optimal way of understanding the data that we had, and essentially so we came up with the six groupings. And then we put these six groupings into an econometric model. So I'm not going to show you coefficients, but basically what you see here is that if the number is higher than one, and if it's green, then it's a significant positive and significant correlation, and if it's minus, like if it's less than zero, less than minus one, then it's negative and significant. So what is striking about this picture is, for example, so this is movie budget, and these are the correlations, and you can see that overall, when in the whole, it doesn't really matter what initial budget you've got, you still end up with a successful film. Whereas, for example, if you wanted to shoot a successful tragedy like Riches to Rex right here, you actually need a large budget. So you need to make it an epic film like Titanic, for example. Or if you think about Marvel movies, the majority of Marvel movies are tragedies. They kind of have this type of pattern. So they go kind of, it gets more and more tragic, more and more moody as you go along. So, for example, think about Infinity War. That's like one of the most successful movies of the last few years, and that kind of shot is shot like this. So the point of this is not that, you know, Man in the Hole is the only type of film that you can make financially successful. No, you can make films and other emotional arcs financially successful, but you have to be very careful about the budget and the genre. So I just showed you the budgets. Let's just say this is the genre. As you can see, Man in the Hole, like, it doesn't really matter pretty much what genre you pick. If you are, for example, shooting a biography, you know, Rex to Riches is probably a good thing to do. You know, it's nice to shoot horror in kind of Riches to Rex, or a thriller like this, but it's a horrible idea to have, for example, a music film or musical or history film in this emotional arc. So basically, you have to be extremely careful in all other categories. And what we wanted to do here is just to say that, you know, you can have input from the viewer at the start of the procedure when you're thinking in terms of making a movie. Okay, so you don't necessarily need to just listen to a small group of people. So this is a piece that we've done for the Comic-Con for the BBC, and it says set superheroes. You can actually, if you Google it, you will probably find my article on BBC on this. But essentially here, what we showed is, so this is just one example. If we take Batman movies, Batman movies were mostly shot as Icarus movies, but you can see that once they made this movie's epic, like it was huge budgets, and made it a tragedy, then they became really financially successful. So it's a Dark Knight movies. Again, it just tells you that you can make a successful movie in a different arc than Man in the Hole, that kind of we found to be the most financially successful. But, you know, you have to be very careful with the budget. So these movies have huge budgets, and, you know, they are epic tragedies, and they have really good financial revenues as a result. So another thing that I want to mention about this project is that when we looked at people's sentiment, for example, we looked at IMDb rankings, we did not find statistically significant difference between various clusters. But what is different about Man in the Hole, and why is this U-shaped form is so successful, is that it generates a lot more debates. So these are not the most liked movies, but these movies are the most the most talked about, the most controversial, if you will. And another thing that we've done since the end of this project is we also asked people to, so when we published this project, we were everywhere, including we went to a Stockholm Film Festival to present the paper to practitioners. And yeah, so where we get most comments is, oh, you know, I don't believe that, you know, this film is this emotional arc. So you need to be careful with that. And we since asked people what they think is an emotional arc of a particular film, and what they told us about Man in the Hole. So they basically, what I can tell you about this is that if we take any other emotional arc, people agree with machine understanding of the emotional arc. But when we ask them about Man in the Hole, they disagree with it. Ah, another thing that I forgot to tell about how exactly we did the analysis is basically, yeah, we took the script, we took each sentence in the script and each word in each sentence, and then we looked at the emotional loading of this word, and then we normalized this emotional loading over a sentence and then over the whole script, and then we drew this kind of timeline. So this is kind of Indian context, and this is Bollywood example. So these are the Bollywood movies, but this I know that these movies are actually in Hindi, but the analysis here is based on the English translation of these films. So what we're doing, so why I'm showing you this is that at the moment, what we're doing with my team is we are actually trying to understand how to basically map emotional arcs for languages other than English, and try to have the comprehensive lexicons in other languages. So, like I said, I mean, this is what you see here is English translations of these respective movies. So what we're trying to do is kind of the international study on this. Okay, responsible personalization. That's kind of the next thing I want to talk about. And responsible personalization is, again, something I'm also passionate about. And here, basically, the point is that, you know, humans are generally biased. And this is a quote from one of the people in my Twitter who said that, oh, you know, thanks a lot for Black Lives Matter graphic. Can I please see a picture of your executive leadership team and company board? And so these are basically all women in the Fortune 500 companies. There are 37 of them. And only 3 of them are women of color, and none of them are Black. So in this particular project, we are basically, so I'm going to show you a project where we use the publicly available data to understand the meaning, the social meaning of race, and algorithmic bias associated with it. But you can also design kind of use similar logic to design a project for a company where you would look at systems developed using algorithms and how these algorithms produce biased system, or how human systems produce biased systems with respect to race. So in this particular project, we look at women, and we particularly look at Black women. And I mean, I'm sure many of you saw this example where, I mean, this is President Obama, and this is the deep learning reconstruction of him. And as so you can see, you get a white guy as a result of this reconstruction. And, you know, that basically tells you that not only humans are biased, but algorithms are also biased. And in this particular project, what we're trying to do is, you know, we know that race is an artificially designed artificially designed concept, but what is important is to understand how deeply it runs in the society, and whether and to what extent it makes sense as a social construct. And In this paper, we just basically show that socially, race is a very ill-defined construct. So for that, we basically to look into this issue, what we did was we mined a female leadership speech, and we used two websites, so Gifts of Speech and Iowa State University Archive of Women's Political Speech. And basically, yeah, we ended up with 757 female leaders and over 2,000 speeches. And we used the speeches to map the topics. So we used topic recognition exercise. And so our hypothesis is, so basically, yeah, usually Black females in leadership roles are considered to be, so first thing is they are considered to be less competent. So that's why there is this misconception that they potentially cannot lead large organizations or something like that. And another problem that we have is normally they are considered to only be concerned with their own issues, you know, with the issues of their communities. But I mean, that just doesn't make any sense. I mean, even if you look at this timeline that I have on the screen right now, these are very, very different women, and they're completely different in their political views and things that they stand for. Like, you can think about, for example, Condoleezza Rice and Oprah and Michelle Obama. I mean, these completely different people. Or Opal Tometi and Patrice Collor. So these are the women who lead Black Lives Matter campaign at the moment. So they do not stand for exactly the same thing. So they all have different interests. So that's one thing. But then kind of these are the things that we learned from speech. So this is our data set. It goes from basically... It goes over 200 years. Like, where you see gaps is basically somewhere where we don't have data really. But we identified these 17 topics. And as you can see, like, women's rights was a pronounced topic up until 20th century, but now women are interested in things like service leadership, resilience and perseverance, power and empowerment, economy, climate change, so environment and development. And the same kind of topics we also see in Black communities. So these are all women in our data set, and these are just the Black women. So you can see that basically the patterns are very, very similar. Historical patterns are very, very similar. So what this shows you is actually that race is, you know, is an ill-defined concept. So there is no clustering in terms of race. So I will show you now also this graph. So what we also found is many of these topics that we found in by topic recognition exercise resonate with global goals. So these women do not just think about their communities, they think about global leadership, they think about global problems. And they identified these global problems way before the global community started to think about them. So these global goals appeared only in 2015, and you know, our data set, like I said, starts like from 1826, I think, or in 1828, something like that. So that's one thing. And second thing is we didn't observe any clustering by race. So this is clustering by profession, and you can see there are clusters. So, but here you cannot see any cluster. So yeah, so what we do here is we basically use topic modeling exercise, and then we use the clusters from topic modeling in an econometric model to understand the correlation. So here, like, the red dependencies mean that it's positive and significant, and the blue ones mean negative and significant. So the point here is if women are represented in any particular area, for example, in any specific topic, for example, in technology, women are underrepresented. They would be underrepresented in every race, not just Black, right? Or Asian or Hispanic or Latino. So we will, or if they're well represented, for example, they're well represented in women's rights and power empowerment topics, so they would be well represented across the board as well. But we would see some clustering and specialization by profession. As you can see, like different profession would be more likely to be interested in different themes. Like, for example, women in business are not very, very much interested in women's rights, but women in arts, audio, video technology and communication, so journalists normally would be very much interested in this topic, things like this. And these are like all women in our data set. And why I wanted to show you this is if we had clustering by race, we would see actually clusters by color. But, you know, these women are interested. So this is basically what we do here is we take all these 17 topics and we project them on a two-dimensional space. And yeah, what if we had a kind of racial specializations, we would actually see clusters here, but we don't see them here. And that just basically means that, yeah, the race is a very ill-defined concept at every level, not just biological level, but also anthropological level, but also at social level. So the last thing I want to show you before we go to questions is this hybrid models. And this is something that I develop, particularly specialize in, and this is data-driven improvement of customer satisfaction project. Here I just want to show you anthropomorphic learning model that I'm working on. So the point of anthropomorphic learning is the following. So you normally have a machine learning or AI, something that you guys study a lot, and kind of deep learning is a part of it, a segment of it. And we have in decision theory all sorts of models of human behavior. So in these models, these are mathematical models where we try to understand how people behave, what features of decision environment they take into account when they're making decisions, so those types of things. So I'm interested in this intersection. You can call it human-centric AI, but basically I'm interested in this anthropomorphic learning models where we combine these models with these models, okay? I assume that you're not very familiar with decision theory, so basically I'm just going to explain to you one of the things that we can do. It's just one of the examples, but basically, in decision theory, if we know a choice set, we can have a very precise predictions about what you're going to choose. So imagine that you're choosing a restaurant. I know it's not a very good example for COVID, but like just imagine that you can, you're not restricted in your choice of a restaurant. And basically, you can have something on campus that is like a canteen or something like this, and you can have a restaurant in the middle of the city, which is quite nice, right? So these two things, X and Y, right? So imagine, so this one is probably like crappy canteen, not very, it's not very tasty food, but relatively cheap and very proximate to you. So you're very close to it. And this one, you have to actually go in the middle of the town to eat there. And it's probably quite expensive. So if we just have these two things, then you will just make a choice based on whatever you prefer. Yeah. But imagine that I can distort this choice, but by giving you an option Z. So this option Z is kind of a bit closer than Y, and kind of quality-wise a little bit better than X. So if I put these two things together, all of a sudden I really highlight the attribute of distance. So it's very likely that you're going to make a decision based on distance. So you're just going to go for X. So you're a lot more likely to select X. Yeah. And then if I put this option W here, so this is kind of like a canteen more proximate to you, like similar to X, and quite distinct from Y, then you will have basically, you will be a lot more likely to choose Y because all of a sudden you highlighted the attribute of quality. So you're saying, okay, these two things are proximate but crappy, but this thing is really nice, but you have to actually go, for an hour to reach this place. So you then you will actually have a like you will be making your decision based on quality. Okay. So in this case, we have this. So the point is that, you know, we from decision theoretic models, we actually know what attributes you like and what attributes will be important given your choice set. So as long as we know what options you're choosing from, that's quite easy to do. And we have all sorts of effects that we can kind of model. So we have all these theories that tell us these effects. So how exactly do we incorporate this into a model? So normally, I mean, this is, of course, very, very basic explanation of neural net. But imagine that you have two options, like X and X1 and X2. Let's just say it's two cars. One car is blue and the other car is red. And they're very similar in terms of their characteristics, but they're different in color. So I know that you are going to be making your decision pretty much based on color, whether you like blue or whether you like red. And I observe your choice right at the end here. So when we design the usual neural net, we basically just take attributes of this object and this object, mix them up, create latent attributes here, and then we will sample each latent attribute sequentially to understand why you made this choice, right? And this is how you formulate the model, and then we just produce the model fit. But in anthropomorphic learning or anthropomorphic sampling procedure, you do not need to sample everything. You can just sample things that you know will make a difference. So for example, here I know that color will make a difference. So I only need to sample bundles that contain the color attribute. I do not need to sample anything else. And that apparently produces very kind of a lot more precise model of behavior and also helps us build better systems. So I'm just going to show you one example how we use it in collaborative, so to improve kind of collaborative filtering, so suggestion systems. So normally our suggestion systems are constructed based on collaborative filtering, either user-based or item-based. I assume you know this. But basically, yeah, I mean, when you choose something on Amazon, you know, if I choose the same kind of books and so, or the same films as someone else, then, you know, they will give me their choices and they will give this other person my choices. And so that's how it is. I mean, item-based is kind of similar logic. But basically, the problem with the system is that it assumes that everything that you buy, you like. That's not always the case. So your decisions are very noisy. So obviously, with our anthropomorphic learning approach, we can correct for that because we know what attributes you like. And I'm not going to go through the personalization chart, but basically, yeah, you can basically create adaptive and implicit systems that will help you actually build these anthropomorphic learning algorithms. And the advantage of these algorithms is that you need a smaller training set. It's a lot faster than the usual, you know, machine learning or deep learning models because, like I said, you slice half of your calculations without losing any power. And then you have pretty high accuracy and the model is fully tractable because you can always go back to the original attributes. And so, yeah, this is one example. So I have one project where we basically test this model in supermarkets. But I mean, this one is just an experimental project where we just had some people watch movies. So we kind of recreated a system very similar to kind of Netflix. And we have basically an experiment where we have groups of people watching movies, and we suggest some movies using different algorithms. So we have one group that just has random selection, so Markov chain process. Then we have neural net that kind of learns the attributes that people like for a while, for 3 months or so, and then gives them suggestions. And then in anthropomorphic learning, we have this type of algorithm that I just described. So we basically also have a learning procedure, but you know, it's based on the decision theory prediction. And so first of all, like, we have a lot higher satisfaction rate from anthropomorphic learning process. And also we also observe that people in this anthropomorphic learning group, they also tend to watch movies a lot more than so on average they basically people watch like one more movie per week in this system, but in anthropomorphic learning group it's over two movies, like on average 2.5 movies every week. So yeah, I mean, this basically suggests to us that this kind of hybrid methodology is also very interesting and potentially quite powerful. So yeah, I mean, I hope I showed you some introduction to to behavioral data science, and yeah, I showed you a few things that you could do with this hybrid modeling approach when you not just use machine learning or linear models to understand what the data says, but also kind of plug it into econometric model or use a hybrid model to better predict people's preferences and understand the decisions better. Yeah, to get more information, I mean, I wrote a short piece for Medium. Like, if you forget what I said today, you can just go there and look at the overview of behavioral data science. We do have a behavioral data science group at the Turing where we have events. So please do join events or watch our podcasts. It's quite normally quite interesting. And like I said, you can attend any event at Turing, not just our events. So you're welcome to do that. We also are going to issue the Cambridge Handbook of Behavioral Data Science. That's going to come probably next year at some point. So we're currently working on this book. And yeah, we also have, I have this data-driven YouTube channel where there are quite a lot of things on behavioral data science. So if you're interested in these things, you can find more information there. So that's all. And I'm happy to go to questions, I guess. Let me just stop sharing. Did I stop sharing? Is that, yeah, okay, cool. So I hope that was a brief intro. So I'm happy to hear questions. Let me just see if I could go to chat. Agraha, did I pronounce it correctly? Do you want to ask your question if you're here?
I think we can just like go through all the questions once. I think that would be
I can just read them then. Cool. Is algorithmic bias the same as human bias, since most algorithms derive their bias from human generated data? Okay, no, it's not the same. the thing is, it may or may not be the same, I just say that. So normally the problem with algorithmic bias is fundamentally different from human bias. So human biases originate in behavioral traits of people. For example, we have limited memory. Like, there is a limited number of things that we can remember. There is like very, very good book. It's called The Mind is Flat by Nick Chater, who's a psychologist. So he wrote kind of these things, like how our mind is not very comprehensive in different ways. There are things like in social situations that we do that is quite weird, could generate the bias. Like, for example, group allocation. Like, if I just, you guys could be quite similar, but if I even just give you random assignment to like yellow and red group, for example, both groups will behave differently and you will treat each other differently. So there are basically human biases depend on human psychology primarily. Algorithmic biases mostly depend on the training set that you have. So if you have very good training set, very precise, very appropriate for a particular context, you will have a very good model. And it could be, you know, the bias could be like minimal. But if you have inappropriate set, so like one of my favorite examples is the training set that was used for recent, so there was a recent model that was basically saying that it could predict, by looking at the photo, it could predict whether you are straight or gay. And the problem was that the training set that was used for that algorithm, and the algorithm was used extensively on, you know, all sorts of pictures, but the training set itself, it was using Tinder pictures. Well, and on Tinder, you don't exactly hide, you know, your sexuality. So So this is an example where you could have a biased algorithm because it was trained on inappropriate data. So they didn't train it on, like, you know, pictures that, for example, were taken in professional setting. But then, you know, it was applied on to pictures of people in professional settings. So that's kind of the type of bias that we're talking about. And yes, to some extent, biased algorithms could have, like, human input, you know, like, labeled inappropriately. But mostly it's because they were labeled in a particular context. It's not because humans deliberately, you know, messed up the system. So that's what I want to say. So they're not, I think the nature is different, very different. Jaska, sorry if I don't pronounce the names correctly. I'm trying. Can you please suggest a movie and a book as you do it in your podcast to understand the field of behavioral analytics? That completely caught me out of guard. Behavioral analytics, I think the best movie I could recommend and the best book I can recommend is the same. It's Moneyball. I really recommend that. I think it's business and behavioral analytics together, a very good, and I think it has a really nice, it's really nice combination of the two. Definitely, you know, on the business side, it's very comprehensive, and, you know, behavioral science is quite comprehensive as well, because you have behavioral traits of, you know, people. So that is something that I also can recommend you. There is a very good film. It's about Formula One, and it's about Niki Lauda and the other guy whose name escapes me. So it's also very good in terms of, you know, seeing behavioral analytics, because Niki Lauda was a Formula One driver who really considered risk in the context of driving. And I might be able.
Would that be Rush?
Yeah, Rush. That's it. Awesome. Yeah. So yeah, exactly. Thank you. Yeah, I was just gonna look for it, but yeah, it is Rush. Yeah, and it's that. So I would suggest. And another movie that I really like. So sorry, it's gonna be the three. It's called Margin Call, and it's a corporate setting. So it's one of, so personally, this is like one of my favorite movies, and also shows you the importance of analytics. And it talks about the 2008 financial crisis and how analytics kind of can trigger these things. So highly recommend that. What kind of data sets do you see, like in the case of...
I think you've mentioned that the IMDb data set and all those things. I think we could.
Yeah. So, I just want to say that, on the data sets in general, I tend to use publicly available data sets. And I think, don't worry if you have, like, publicly available data set, because a lot of people think, oh, I need some fancy data set from Google or whatever. I need to buy it from Twitter. Like, I bought stuff from Twitter, which is completely trash. Like, I can give you an example. Like, we, with one of my co-authors, we bought a data set from Twitter for which we paid a lot of money. And it had over 10 million observations. And then after we cleansed it, we ended up with 20 observations.
So, definitely. I mean, even we had a similar issue, you know, we were trying to use the official APIs to extract the tweets, and then we found out there were a lot of duplicates in them. So yes, I think you're right.
Yeah. So, like, yeah, just trust your own kind of judgment in that, and go for publicly available stuff, because it's, you know, it's accessible and you can do that. Right. Can the slides be?
I think the next one would be.
Sorry.
Do you use F-score and collaborative filtering?
Yeah, I just want to say on slides that I'm going to give Akshay and Harshith my slides, and they could be shared after the session. I don't mind. Definitely. There's nothing secret in my slides, so you can definitely use them and you can have them.
So there is the next question. Do you use F-score in the collaborative filtering?
You can do all sorts in collaborative filtering. Like, in principle, yeah, we tried different versions, and the only thing that I haven't tried, and I think it will be very powerful, is Bayesian. So because I know that there are, you know, there are ways to do Bayesian things, but I'm not Bayesian myself, so I normally rely on co-authors to sort of advise me on Bayesian. I'm frequentist by training. So I do sometimes Bayesian analytics, but it's normally kind of supervised by someone who knows this stuff. Yeah, at the moment, for example, I'm learning Julia, where I think a Bayesian innovation is necessary. So yeah, but in terms of like collaborative filtering, what I want to say is that it's not about the collaborative filtering itself, it's about the assumptions on the preferences. So the assumption of the on the preferences when you're making choices in consumer choice is that everything you buy you like. And that's not the case. Like, you have to consider the noise, and potentially, you know, if you can have a model that is incorporates noise parameters, it could be quite powerful. So you might not need the anthropomorphic learning. Like I said, like, I know that my approach works in the setting that I showed, and also in, so there is another project that we have where we basically work with this. Well, it was pre-COVID, so we worked with supermarket, where like large shopping mall. It's not a supermarket, large shopping mall, where we gave people an app, and it's like Tinder for offers, like shop offers, and you can like or dislike it, and we also give suggestions based on these three different algorithms. And yeah, so again, there, like, our model performs better than others only because we do not assume that if you went to, I don't know, H&M, that you really like H&M stuff, you know. It could be like any random reason why you went there. Okay. Yeah, Moneyball, yeah, I can, yeah. So Moneyball, Margin Call, and Rush. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, guys. What Alan Turing Institute is doing for education and AI? Yes. Okay. That's a very important and very frustrating question. So we do have a PhD pro. So there are several things. Like, first thing that anybody can attend is events, and we have master classes and events. And I highly recommend that you guys check them out. There are very cool talks and very technical as well. So not, you know, just a brief introduction, but you can actually get in-depth stuff there. So that's one thing. Second thing, we do have data study groups. There are a lot of restrictions on those. I mean, you're not restricted if you're not British or you are not permanent resident in the UK. You can go to this, but there are normally restrictions on whether you should be like registered for a course in the UK, like all sorts of things. So you need to check that. So data study groups are cool because it's like hackathon that runs over 2 weeks. It's nice. I hope that with online ways of engagement, you will be able to, like, people like you guys would be able to attend, you know, even though you're undergraduate students. But I mean, at the moment, unfortunately, there are many restrictions on them. But do check them out. Like, when the announcements come out, I normally put them on my LinkedIn and Twitter. So, you know, do check them out. And sometimes you can actually attend things and take part in them. So that's one part. Then we used to have a PhD program, which was a 3-year program, and you could get funding. And if you were very good, you could get funding for 3 or 3.5 years, or even 4 and 4.5 years sometimes. But that stopped because there was really high demand, and the institute wanted to provide kind of more places for people to be able to engage. So currently there is a so-called enrichment program rather than PhD program. So that means that you would need to enter a UK university, but then you can apply for 1 year of enrichment with Turing, and you will be fully funded for that, and you will be able to use the facilities of the institute. And yeah, it's not restricted to any nationality as far as I know. I don't know what's going to happen with COVID and funding, but yeah, that's another option. But certainly, like I said, remember that all events are free, and they are normally designed for the students. So, people will be talking about methods, like how exactly they did everything, like where they got the data, so all this type of stuff. So do check out the events. What are some of the interesting problems in behavioral data science? So mostly we are concerned with, like I said, the humans, the algorithms, and systems. And the problems are quite varied. So as long as they concern behavior, so everything that is concerned behavior is of interest. So on our page you can actually see like the whole kind of range of problems. A lot of people are interested, for example, in well-being and historical well-being and how well-being travels through time, and you know, those types of things. Smart cities is another big one. Cybersecurity or security generally, how do you, for example, I work on cybersecurity and how do you use behavioral segmentation to identify cyber criminals or cyber criminal targets or something like this. So very interesting. Like we have, for example, some people who work on dark web and, you know, like all these types of things. And they're trying to understand patterns in language of, you know, criminals and all sorts. So, yeah, so there are a variety of problems. But yeah, I mean, mostly we want to understand how we can incorporate kind of human values into these AI systems and how we can better understand behavior and how we can help design better algorithms, you know, for different contexts so that they could better collaborate with people. Can you explain the difference of the recommended system concept and behavioral data science? Yes. So recommendation systems, I guess that's what you mean, is just one practical application of behavioral data science. So it's not a part of behavioral data science. I was just trying to explain that one of the use cases that you could imagine for the models that I work on are in suggestion systems or recommendation systems, because this is normally very problematic algorithms in AI, and they don't predict people's preferences very well. But what I wanted to say is, like, in decision theory, we do have models that predict people's preferences quite well. And by merging the two, you know, you can actually potentially could have very powerful recommendation system algorithm. Is there any collaborative program for PhD students in the Alan Turing Institute? I'm not sure what that means, Murukesan. If you're here, maybe you could just expand on this. A collaborative program. Go ahead.
Yes, actually, I'm currently doing PhD in NIT in Warangal. So, is there any way to collaborate with your institute on any lines? Yes, I'm asking about that.
It's a good question. I don't really know whether there are I know that there are different projects. So we normally advertise projects, and you could become like a part of the project team. And I don't think that's restricted to nationality or something. They just announced internship programs, and I know someone asked me, like, can someone from India, for example, participate? And I mean, it's not restricted to nationality, but it is restricted to being, like I said, being like affiliated with British University and things like this. So things do come up. I don't know. I know that there is an international program within Turing. So I guess the way to answer your question is I need to find out. And then maybe it's through Akshay I could inform you. But yeah, generally, I think you can, yeah, if you just look at kind of projects and jobs, you can get a short project. Like very often I have, for example, short projects where people could just come in and, you know, just work on a project. So that's I think the most the easiest way to getting into kind of working with a Turing fellow, because we normally have projects that are like 3 months or 6 months where you need help. And so I would recommend kind of going through that route and applying through that route. But in terms of like programs of collaboration, I don't know. But you definitely can engage with people. Like if you just wanted to work with someone, I suggest you attend an event. If you can, if you see a person you really want to work with, just write them an email And don't be shy and just say, oh, you know, I'm really interested in this topic. Like, can I help with anything? And normally people have stuff that they want to collaborate on. So, yeah, normally, like, many people in Turing are very approachable. It's nothing scary about them. Can you explain that? What are the opportunities being provided for us and the grad students in India, and also tell the path we should follow? Yeah, like I said, the best thing is check out the events regularly, and if you want to work like with a particular person, just approach them and see if they have projects. And very often we do have short projects where you could, you know, could collaborate on a project. Is behavioral algorithms gaining significance in autonomous vehicles? If yes, can you tell in brief and how? Okay, this is a great question. So I used to work for Warwick Manufacturing Group, and there is a whole group there who works in autonomous vehicles. So you should invite them and they will tell you more precisely. As far as I know, there is some research in neuroscience. So in like behavioral science, we do have like a strength called neuroscience. There are definitely people who do hybrid kind of neuroscience algorithms for autonomous vehicles. Like, for example, when you fall asleep, you know, at the wheel, which is like a very big problem in the UK, for example. The algorithms will trace that. There is a group I could recommend in Warwick Manufacturing Group, so you should really invite them and they will tell you all about it. But yeah, there are behavioral algorithms for that, and they do have several fellows who work on behavior. Driver's behavior, driver's risk taking, it's now called human operators of autonomous vehicles. But yeah, there are people who do that. And the only project I did was on cybersecurity of connected cars, not autonomous, but connected. So something that we all drive to some extent. So I can only talk about that, but yeah, if you want to get it, like an overview of autonomous vehicles, I can recommend some people who could talk about that. Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So that was very cool. Thank you.
it is. So today's session is really informative, it's a great honor for us to have such an eminent personality here as a speaker.
Thanks a lot, and thank you for coming. And if you want to know more about behavioral data science, like I said, we will have a handbook coming out next year. I'm trying to make sure that it's not like overpriced. So there will be some ways to, like, we will also have an online repository with the book, so that would be free. So hopefully you all be able to access things. Yeah.
Thank you so much for your time, Gana. Thank you once again. It was really an informative session, as Akshay rightly mentioned. And I think you've aroused a lot of our interests in the field of behavioral data science specifically, you know. So I think a lot of them will be connecting with you on LinkedIn and Twitter, and we will hopefully see more of these collaborations in the future. Thank you so much.
Yeah, no worries. Thank you. Yeah, thanks a lot for the invitation. And like I said, you can collaborate with Alan Turing Institute. I just want to say that Alan Turing Institute is a place that rewards people who are persistent. Like, yeah. For example, I myself only became a fellow from this my third attempt. You know, if you engage with people who work there and you say that, okay, you know, I'm really excited about this topic, I work on this, can I potentially help somewhere, then there is a way to always attract attention and engage. So don't be afraid of doing that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, thanks a lot. And yeah, have a nice evening.
Thank you, Prof. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.